Welcome back to Third Phase of Moon. My name's Blake Cousins. Our guest this week, Carrie Cassidy. Project Camelot is her passion. Talking to whistleblowers from around the world in regards to UFOs, teleportation, alien abduction, and government secrets. Let's get to it right now. Carrie, thanks for joining us right here at Third Phase of Moon.
Thanks, Blake. Looking forward to it.
Carrie, you've been working very hard for decades trying to get information out and interviews from whistleblowers, and you've spoken to the top around the world. What more is it going to take to get disclosure from the U.S. government?
Well, you have to understand what they have to disclose, which is the alien presence, lots of different races, their underground bases, their secret space program. My point of view on disclosure is that regardless of what they disclose, they're going to lie to you. So they're going to spin it. They're going to make it seem more simplistic than it really is. But once they open that sort of can of worms and give validation of any kind to the sector, then people like us that have been out there fighting the good fight, trying to get the truth out, are we're going to really sort of hit the public in a major way, and we will go mainstream, so to speak. And when that happens, we will scare the shit out of them. Because the information, for example, on Camelot, where we have more than 300 hours of audio and video footage with whistleblowers with above top secret clearances, researchers, authors, experiencers, all kinds of people, we really have a huge treasure trove, if you will, of information that will blow this whole sector open. So anything they say, they're going to be able to come to us and get more depth. And when that happens, we're just waiting.
Carrie, can I ask you, in your lifetime of research, who are the top two people you've spoken to about government cover-up in regards to UFOs and the agenda?
Well, that's a hard question. I can't really narrow it down quite that much. I can tell you some very important people that we've interviewed. One of the most important, I would say, is Henry Deacon, who came out under his own name, which is Arthur Neumann. And he basically went on stage with me in Barcelona and said he'd been on Mars working as a scientist. He has gone to ground, as they say. So since our interview and since our dialogues with him, in which we really investigated him in depth and spent a lot of time with him, we got to be very good friends with him. And basically, he's been shut up. He's been intimidated. So he's one very important person. I don't know. I guess. For the mainstream, I would say Bob Dean is a really important person, and in many ways, Bob, even though he'd been on the sector for a very long time, speaking at conferences and so on, when he came to me, he really opened up. At one point, he burst into tears, talking about his own contact experience, and Bob became something like, for lack of a better word, almost a rock star in this sector. And his wonderful heart and his incredible personality and his sense of truth and justice really pervades everything he does and says. And he's something of a hero for people. So I would say he's a very important person that we interviewed.
Talking about Mars, do you think NASA's doing some kind of cover-up in regards to information and possible life there? And what's up with Curiosity? Are they really sending images back, or are they suppressing some of the images and not giving it to the public? Overall, what is NASA up to? Are they a deception kind of agency?
Well, there's definitely a cover-up, and for that you can look at Richard Hoagland and his book, Dark Mission, which talks about the cover-up and NASA. And but as far as Henry Deacon goes, being on Mars, he took a jump room, what was called a jump room. And we also have an interview with, it was actually more of a video conversation with David Wilcock, in which we discuss the jump room. It's called Jump Room to Mars. And we discuss Daniel, David Wilcock's whistleblower, who had an experience. I don't think he didn't go to Mars, but he had experience with Montauk, etc. anyway, and we talk about the jump room, and he verifies that he's aware of the jump rooms as well. Basically, I've been told by other witnesses that there are jump rooms or jump gates within the various underground facilities. There's one in Los Alamos. There's one in, probably there's, there must be one in Pine Gap. There's so much going on there. Dimona, a lot of underground bases are associated with various other military facilities, such as Dimona in Israel.
Carrie, can you tell us, what is the most scariest testimony you've ever heard so far?
I don't know. One of the best pieces of information that I got relatively recently is from a whistleblower who came forward, but he never was interviewed. And he told me that this planet was being ruled from the fourth dimension, and that that there were jump gates in places like Texas on bases and in Los Alamos where people were, the military jumps back and forth to Mars, but it's not Mars as we know it. It's Mars in a fourth dimensional Mars. And so that when we look at the surface of Mars, we're not actually seeing what's really there. What's happening though is that Earth is moving into the fourth dimension. And in fact, some people would say we're actually already there. So this is where you get the veil thinning between the various dimensions, and we are definitely starting to access and see a lot more in terms of the number of ships visiting, the kinds of races that we're going to be encountering, and so on. I mean, for all intents and purposes, we are joining the galactic community.
People theorize that there are many species of aliens visiting Earth right now. Could you give us a description of what they may look like, and really, how many species are existing here at the moment, right now, as we speak, on planet Earth?
Well, Clifford Stone, who is an excellent whistleblower, who worked as an intuitive that would go along with the military when they were recovering crashed UFOs back in the, I think it was the 1960s and 70s. He's retired now, and he's having a lot of trouble with staying alive. But at any rate, he's talked about as many as 54 different races when he was exposed to and sort of on the inside of the military. My understanding is there's a lot more than 54. As far as descriptions of them, people will know about the grays and the reptilians. There are many, many groups of grays, and there are also what are called programmed biological entities, and those are, they look like grays, but they're basically robots. So there's that group. There's, you know, all different kinds of reptilians. There's positive, what we call service to self and service to others reptilians, the Shikars, which are reptilians with wings and fly between the dimensions. Let's see, there are all kinds of hybrids. Humanity itself is a hybrid. So we are a hybrid race, and we are made up of many different races, as much as 12 different ET races. There's the Andromedans, there's so many races. I can't even tell you. The Nordics, there are many kinds of Nordics. A lot of people tend to group them all together. They put the Pleiadians and Nordics all in one bin. They're not the same races. They're different. They come from different areas of the galaxies and so on. So there's praying mantis beings. There's there's a bizarre looking beings. I mean, what was that? Is it Men in Black or I think it's Men in Black. Yeah, that movie in some ways depicts something of the bizarre quality of what we're talking about.
Who do we got to be more concerned about, the alien agenda or the U.S. government agenda, or are they in collaboration at the same time?
Well, I would say they're as far as the negative ETs, the service to self, and the secret government, they are working hand in hand, so they're equally diabolical. The agenda involves taking over the planet, eliminating 2/3 of the population on the planet, turning the rest into slaves, and so on. And there are many ET races with many different agendas. There are also positive ETs that are working in the background to keep us going, to keep humanity as an experiment, which is what we are, alive and flourishing on this planet. The secret space program is divided as well into what we consider to be white hats and black hats. And they are basically, the white hats are trying to take back their power at this time, to turn the tables on the ETs, where the secret space program made a number of treaties and agreements with the dark side.
I've heard word over the internet and through special sources about the robot man or the super robot. Can you tell us a little bit more about what the government is planning to do with human DNA and technology, wrapping it all together?
I like to talk about what is in essence going on here on the planet, which has to do with two paths of choice that humanity has at this time, to go the way of what I call the robotic Superman versus the angelic human. The secret space program, for all intents and purposes, chose the robotic Superman. They chose the machine, the sort of merging of man and machine as being the future for humanity. They didn't want to wait for humanity to evolve on its own, to move into its own power, its own abilities. That this human body has incredible potential. We are a time traveler. That's our nature. We have the ability to go and to leave and return to our body at will, to actually disappear from this reality and move somewhere else. We have the ability to fly and to do all the things that you've heard of, the special powers, ET, type powers. These are embodied in this vehicle, this human vehicle. It's just that Earth humans have not actualized themselves sufficiently to be able to utilize all those powers at this time. But we are very much moving in that direction as a species, and we will gradually embrace all of those potentialities if allowed to develop and continue to grow in the future. We're also having a great deal of help right now by the energetics that are coming into the planet at this time, and the positive ET energies that are helping us to move us into actualizing what we are in essence destined to be. So if you think of us as a composite of 12 ET races, then you can understand that we have all those same powers as all those so-called ETs that a lot of channelers and other people tend to put on a pedestal. There's no reason to put them on a pedestal if you understand that we actually embody all their powers and more, because we are greater than the sum of our parts, if you will. So this is a grand experiment. At least 12 ET races took part in it. And this is a being that creator wanted to see succeed and to move and back to creator eventually. What happens is that the robotic Superman is going to be using the machine, the AI, and emphasizing that in composite with the human. And what the problem with machine reality and AI is that they have no soul. And so this is where you get a lot of envy from some of the races that don't have a soul, the androids that are visiting the planet, etc. The robotic races, they all wish to create and to have a soul, but they simply are unable to do so. So this is where you get the merging of the two, where there's a desire to do that. All they can do is replicate themselves. They can't evolve. They can't re-evolve and go back to source.
You speak of the jump room. Is this human-made technology or help from extraterrestrials? Are they working together with this jump room from planet to planet?
Well, I'm sure the technology came from RET interactions. The government's been involved with ETs, at least in terms of what we know of, since the 1940s. And they've had treaties with them. that involve abductions of human beings in exchange for getting high technology and various other things. The reptilians and the greys are the most notorious. There's also the Nordics and many other races. Technology for jump rooms, I assume, came from the ETs, although my understanding is also that the Nazis were in touch with a certain great race of ETs, and they probably had already developed something of a jump gate using the Nazi bell.
Carrie, this has been an amazing interview, and we've gotten some incredible information. I want to thank you for all your hard work that you're doing over there at Project Camelot, talking to the whistleblowers, getting above top secret information in the hands of the public. Thanks again, Carrie, for joining us right here at Third Phase of Moon.
Oh, thank you very much. I hope to see you guys again.
Thanks again, Carrie. I suggest everybody to check out Project Camelot. The link's below. You take a look, and if you've got information that you think is above top secret, let her know. And if you've captured anything amazing in regards to UFOs, contact Third Phase of Moon via Skype or Facebook. Visit our new website at www.thirdphaseofmoon.net. My name's Blake Cousins, and we'll see you again next time.